Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. It's Monday evening. We are here to do the thing that we do every Monday once again, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. Today we are continuing our discussion on the age-old question of whether tone really is in the hands. Now people say this all the time and they go like, hey man, like, you know, tone's in the fingers, gear doesn't really matter, bro, all that sort of stuff. But what does that even mean, right? What does that even involve? Like, you know, like, how can your tone be in your hands? How can it be in your gear, etc., etc., etc.? We discussed this at length last week, but if you are just joining us, fear not, we are going to be getting into great detail about this rather sticky topic. But before we do that, just want to take a moment to say hi to everybody. It's great to have you on board. These streams really are the highlight of my week. I just love, love, love hanging out with you guys, talking about guitar. It's a pleasure and a privilege. If you guys are enjoying these streams and you'd like to support them, there are a few ways you can do it. The most obvious and the easiest way that you can support this stream that costs you precisely nothing is to give us a thumbs up, a subscribe, and to share this with your guitar playing friends. However, if you're ready to take our relationship to the next level, you can check out GI Plus, which is where you'll find lesson content from the likes of myself, Tom Quayle, Andy James, Rick Graham, etc. You guys have heard me talk about this all the time, but I cannot stress to you how good GI Plus really, really is. There's so much great stuff in there. We have so many very, very happy members who visit us in our streams, which is just killer. And also, let's not forget as well that if you are a GI Plus subscriber and you want to chat to me about any of the courses that you're studying, or you have any questions about any of the material there within, you can ask me right here on these live streams, which says so right down here, happen every Monday right here on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel at 8 p.m. GMT, down there, 3 p.m. EST, 12 noon PST. So let's just check in with the stream and let's see who's with us this evening. PJ was first through the door, says, good evening, Nick and everyone. PJ, it's great to have you. Marcine, returning friend of the stream and a fine guitar player, is joining us this evening. Dr. Richard Juricka, I'm going to butcher your name. My accent probably doesn't help with that. Richard, it's great to have you on board. Timothy Appling, who I keep calling Timothy Appalling, that is going to be his punk band name, is joining us from Florida Keys. Incidentally, if you're tuning in for the first time, or you're tuning in for a second, third, fifth, hundredth time, doesn't really matter to me, I'm glad to have you on board. Let us know where you're watching from. I'd love to know whereabouts in the world you guys are tuning in from. Roy Lisbon says, Nick the Shredder, I won't lie, I saw that comment pop up during the intro jam and I turned up the shred just because I had a little smile on my face. Joe Johnson, UK, says, evening, Nick. Evening, all. Nick killing it as usual. Joe, he's very kind of you. Joe and I have chatted on Instagram. Joe's a great guy. If you have any questions, by the way, feel free to message me on Instagram. You can do it on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel, or the Guitar Interactive Instagram account, which is at Guitar Interactive, or my own personal account, which is at Nick Jennison. You can do that on the proviso that you give either of us a follow while you're there. Love to chat to you guys. I'm always game to talk about guitar. David Yates says, just had an hour live stream with Kiko Luero, whose name I can't pronounce. Never a live stream with the second maestro of the evening, Nick Jennison. Yeah, buddy. Very, very kind of you. Thank you very much. I will try my best to live up to those high standards. Kiko is an absolute monster. He's a favorite of mine. And I gotta say, a really, really nice dude. I had the pleasure of interviewing him at Bloodstock a few years ago. Really great dude. Like, really, really friendly, quiet guy. Very insightful, very knowledgeable about the instrument. Couldn't pronounce his name then either, which was equally embarrassing, I'm sure you'll agree. Steve McDee says, hi all from Switzerland. Hi Steve, it's great to have you on board. Don't think we've had too many Swiss viewers so far, so it's lovely to have you with us. Really glad you could join us. Sacred Godslayer says, good evening. Mark McNish says, hello all, more finger tone please. Sacred Godslayer, there's this guitar, inter-attractive. I try my best, you know. I work out, did I mention that? Joking. Blue Sumlin says, evening all. Blue Sumlin, a long-time friend of the streams. Blue Sumlin, I promise I'll do some more blues for you soon. Udayan Mustafi, I think I got that. Hey, says, hey, you got this. So I must have got it. There you go. Frank is back in saying, hi, Nick. Frank, it's great to have you. My personal channel. Good evening from Nick. Thanks for continuing this topic. Hey, no problem. My personal channel was one of the members of our stream last week. And we kind of got to the end of our session and decided, hey, you know what it is? We haven't really finished talking about this stuff. So we decided to continue it this week. And if you are part of our streams, you get to help decide on the topics that we discuss, which is very cool. Scott Wakenshaw, a good friend of mine, my drummer's brother, or rather my drummer is his brother because Scott is the elder, says, evening to you, you good? Scott, I am great. It's great to have you, man. I hope you're keeping well. Hope you're enjoying that new guitar of yours. Larry Warren says, greetings from Canada. We do love a bit of Canada. Finger Monday says, cow cat. Yes, indeed. Bring in the comedy. John Dean says, hello from VA, USA. Oh, help me. Virginia, USA, I want to say. If I've got that wrong, John, I apologize. I'm not that great at my state initialisms. I should be better. Lake Eureka with a J, Jureka. Hey, that's cool. I like that. Very, very nice. Larry Lopez is tuning in from Hollister, California. We're going to be in California in June, and I cannot wait. Here we go. Andy Keeley, another friend of mine. We go way, way back, says, hi, Nick. Watching with mouth open at your talent, as always. Very kind. Very kind. Alan Stevens says, from Maui here. You guys are all tuning in from, like, really, really warm places, which makes me jealous because I'm sat in Newcastle where it is still very cold. Starting to get a bit warmer through the day, but it's still pretty cold of an evening. But that's okay because we have guitars. I'm surrounded by valve amps or tube amps for our American friends, and I am a happy boy. So anyway, I think Steve Hawthorne has summed this up for us very well. We're going to talk a little bit about some of the stuff that we went into last week, and then we'll go into greater detail. But let's not forget as well, I want your guys' opinions on this. I want you to let me know in the comments if you have any thoughts on this subject. I'm going to be asking you questions throughout the stream. Drop me a comment, let me know what you think. But Steve Hawthorne says, evening, Nick. Great playing as usual. Thank you very much, Steve. In my opinion, tone has a lot to do with your fingers, i.e. pick attack, feel bending, vibrato triggered by passion. Now, let's get into the nuts and bolts of this. So last week we discussed what gear tone involves. Now gear tone, we established, was things like this, for example, which is a clean sound. Going to this, which is a very dirty sound. So on and so forth, with every gradation in between, such as this guy. Which is a little less dirty. We have something like this guy, which is a fuzz. And everything in between. So that is, from a tone perspective, kind of where a gear is coming from. We also have things like EQ on the amp, and we have things like the speaker cab that we're using. Incidentally, I feel like the speaker cabinet is really, really underrated in terms of the tone that we're getting. So what I'm gonna do real quick, let me just show you this. This is, I'm playing through a Boss Wazza tube amp expander right now. I'm gonna show you the difference that a couple of IRs make. So really quickly, let's just delve into this. Let me just quickly set this up. Bear with me, hopefully this is not gonna make everything go catastrophically wrong. I completely forgot that I need to stream to my Apple TV. There we go. This is how I make this screen sharing thing work. So we'll get to that. And then real quick, let's see if this has done its thing yet. It's telling me Apple TV is still there. Once we give it a quick second for that to go away, I'm certain I'll be able to show you this. But speakers real quick. So I'm playing through a Boss Wazza tube amp expander. I'm using a couple of different speaker cabs. I'm using my favorite cab right now, which is an Engl Celestion IR. Let's just check on that. Let's see if that's working now. Nope, still here. Let me see if I can get rid of that real quick. Let's just see if that's worked. Hey, there we go. Cool. So now what you can see right up here is my, I'll shift this so you guys can see what's going on. That's my Logic project. This is the editor for the tube amp expander. I want to show you the difference that our speaker cabs make, because we're talking about gear real quick. So let's carry on with this. So at the moment, I'm playing through this right here, which is my favorite IR. That is an Engl V Vintage 30 cab with a 57 and a 121. It's a Celestion IR. Celestion IRs, best in the business, in my opinion, although other IRs are available. Let's just compare this to another Vintage 30 cab, also from Celestion. And to keep it nice and even, I'm gonna keep the room switched on. So let's go to that one. I'm gonna make sure that we've got the big room engaged. Let's just write that across. There we go. Okay, so this right here, this is our Engl cab with the delay switched on. Let's just turn the delay off to keep it nice and simple. So we get this. Okay, another Vintage 30 cab, right? It's Vintage 30, so it's got to be pretty similar, right? Take a listen to this. I'm going to switch as I'm playing. What? Huge difference. Let's just compare that again. Here we go. So this is cab one. Here comes cab two. Man, that's a big difference. Let's compare that real quick to a Greenback cab. Again, I'm just going to switch the big room sound on. So here we go. This is this is the original cab that I play through all the time. Greenbacks. Vintage 30s. Now this becomes more and more interesting as we start to dial the gain back. So let's go to a slightly cleaner sound. That's our alternate Vintage 30 cab. Let's go to the original V30 cab. Greenbacks. Giggles, let's go to a, oh, I don't know, 1x15. So a really, really overlooked aspect of your tone is your cab. Now, this is interesting because the speaker cabinet doesn't just interact with the sound of your amp or whatever you're playing through, it also interacts with your playing in a very interesting way that we're gonna get to in a moment. So we've kind of pretty much covered all of the stuff that is definitely gear. There's definitely gear in the sense, this is how I define it, in the sense that you're not physically playing it. You're not physically touching it. Now, let's get into the slightly sticky gray area stuff that we talked about last week. So gray area stuff are things like pickups, settings on the guitar, and string gauge. Now, an action height to an extent, I guess, because these are all things that are going to affect your tone, but they are something that you are physically interacting with while you're playing. So your choice to either play on the neck pickup or the bridge pickup, for example, is going to affect your tone. Obviously, we knew that already, but let's just compare. Here is going to be bridge pickup, neck pickup, bridge, neck, bridge, neck. Let's do some other stuff. Let's play with the guitar's tone control real quick. So bridge tone up, bridge tone down, neck pickup tone up, neck pickup tone down. So those are all kind of sticky stuff. Now, what I can't do live on camera for you guys, when I could be really bored watching me do it, is I can't switch between string gauges. We've talked about strings at some length in a previous Guitar Interactive lesson series where we discussed, does string gauge matter? That's something that you guys can check out on the Guitar Interactive website, guitarinteractive.magazine.com. Guitarinteractivemagazine.com. You can check that out over there. We won't get into that today because it would require me restringing my guitar on camera. I'm pretty quick at restringing, but you guys don't want to see that. That's going to be dull. So we have discussed all of the sort of gear aspects. Let's quickly recap, very quickly. We're going to recap the definitely playing aspects. So the most obvious one that is definitely playing that we talked about last week is dynamics. Now, dynamics are going to have a different effect depending upon what sound you're playing through. So if we go through this sound, which is a clean sound, I'm going to go to my back pickup, or rather my front pickup. I'll go to my neck pickup. These are Fishman Fluence Classics, which are real, real open sounding, very, very path-like, but with this extended high-end thing that I can take off, but I kind of like it. So I'm going to leave it on. Dynamics, anyway, if I play with a very clean sound, if I play softly, it's just going to get quieter. But if I play loudly, it's going to get louder, but it's also going to sound different. So let's take a quick listen to that. Listen to the vowel quality of what I'm playing here. And to probably illustrate this better, I'm going to stick with the clean sound. But I'm going to turn my compressor on. So I'll turn my compressor on and may even double compress this. I'm even throw another compressor on so we really kill the dynamics, but we keep it super, super clean. So take a listen to this. This is just the effect of dynamics on the tone of our string. I'm going to stick on the neck pickup, so we're not going to change. So when it gets really bright and forward sounding, that's not going to be the bridge pickup. You might think it would be me switching from neck to bridge, but it shan't be. What I'm going to do instead is I'm going to stay perfectly placed right here in the middle of the string. I'm going to try and be fairly equidistant between the two pickups. You'll be able to see from the white pick that I'm using, even though it's not my favorite, because I love you guys and I want you to be able to see my pick against the guitar. What I want from you, dear viewer, is I want you to tell me what you think you're hearing as I go from soft to loud. So you tell me what you're hearing. Let's do this. Here we go. Let's start with some medium type playing. Go real soft. Let's go real hard. Real soft. So what are you guys hearing in the tone there? I have gone to great lengths to try and even out the dynamics. We've gone to the cleanest of clean sounds, which is my Victory V4 Countess preamp. Super clean, great clean sound. I mean, it just does this thing, which is gorgeous. Nice, but that's not what we're talking about. So let's see what you guys are saying. This is interesting. Sacred Godslayer says, the harder you pick, the more high end comes forth. Now this is sort of true. Sort of true. Blue Sumlin says, more clarity when you're playing soft. Yep, I can agree with that. David Yates says, more high frequency when we're digging in. Cowcat says, attack eats string. Yeah, that's kind of true. Steve Hawthorne says, more definition with harder picking. Now, this is interesting because Blue Sumlin said the opposite, said more clarity when playing soft. Mark McNish sounds more like some spring snap. I'm guessing that string snap when we play hard. Timothy Appling's kind of summed it up really well. More bite with hard. Thomas Ross says the sound of the pick. Yeah, 100%. You can hear that chirp sound as we start to pick harder. So if we go back to that sound that I had a second ago with the super compressed tone, we can hear that pick chirp. That kind of sound coming through, especially on the back pickup when we start to really dig in. Now, picking unreasonably hard like that is going to have an effect on the tone. And what it does is it seems to bring forward not so much the high end. This is interesting, right? Because this is, now who said this? David Yates. So more high frequency when you dig in. It's kind of true. It's not so much high frequency as much as it is upper mid range. Now, interestingly, as guitar players, because we don't really have a lot of genuine high end in terms of like actual like 10K and up, or even like 6K and up in terms of frequency range. Don't worry if you don't know what any of that stuff means, by the way. That's perhaps another story for another day. We tend to perceive high end in our own sound as being like 2 kilohertz and up, maybe 2 to 5K, which is very interesting because if we increase let's actually do this with an EQ real quick. If we increase the level of like this 2 to 5K band, we hear things as being way, way louder. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to just bring you back to my my sound real quick. Let me show you this. So this is our edit. You can see we've got an EQ here real quick. Let's just take 2 kilohertz, which is this guy right here. Let me make sure I'm on Do Not Disturb because I don't want to be bothered by people while we're doing this. That's better. Okay, so let's start turning 2.5K up with a fairly moderate Q value. And what you'll hear is we get loads and loads and loads of extra loudness, I guess. Let's turn that up, see what happens. Again. Experiment with a very, very interesting phenomenon here in a second, but let's keep sticking with that. Let's maybe go to 3.2K. We're going to boost maybe 10 dB of this. What I'm going to do is I'm going to turn the level down and we'll see if we can match that coming in. So just got 9 on meters here. Let's do that. Picking the same level. Just a little too quiet there. Let me try that experiment again. Let's turn the EQ on and off with this big boost here. And then without. Now this is interesting. What I want you guys to tell me real quick is, which one of these sounds do you think is louder? Do you think the sound with the EQ on is louder, or the sound with the EQ off? You tell me. Take a listen to this, right? Which one's louder? And I'll tell you which one's actually louder in a second. So this is with the EQ off. This is with the EQ on. EQ off. EQ on. Let's actually turn it on. Off. On. Which one of those sounds louder to you? You tell me, was it EQ off or EQ on? And also, while we're doing this, let me know what you're listening on. What are you listening to this stream on? Are you listening on your phone? You're listening on your TV? You're listening on your laptop speakers? I want to know, because that's going to give me some context for what you guys are hearing. So everybody here is saying EQ off is louder. You are absolutely correct. The EQ off is louder. But what's interesting is where I'm sat, I'm hearing the EQ on as being louder than EQ off. Now what's fascinating about this is this push in these upper mids is normally what we hear as high end as guitar. High end as guitar. Now we're getting some contrary opinions here. So some people are listening on various devices, they're getting EQ off. This is interesting. Sacred Godslayer says off is louder, but it seems that it has less space listening on monitors. Very interesting, very interesting. On AirPods, says iPad and pods, says PJ, off was louder. That's interesting, because you're actually able to hear the low end going on there. Now, we're getting all sorts of stuff here. EQ on sounds louder on headphones, says Marcin. This is a very interesting psychoacoustic phenomenon. EQ on is louder in the high frequencies, Bluetooth earbuds, says Roy Lisbon. Psychoacoustic phenomenon, anyway, it's called the Fletcher-Munson effect. So the Fletcher-Munson effect basically states, it's an effect that we that affects the way we hear different frequencies. So the way it works is we're more sensitive to frequencies in the 2 to 5 kilohertz region than we are to frequencies in other areas. Same is true for very low frequencies like 150 hertz and down over. But basically what happens is when we turn these frequencies up, this kind of scoop type EQ, it generally sounds a little louder to us. Now, this is also an interesting perception between the way engineers perceive EQ and the way guitar players perceive EQ. Guitar players tend to think about high end as being like I say, around kind of like 2K, 5K, that sort of territory. Engineers tend to think about high end as being a little higher up than that, in a territory that doesn't really make a huge difference to guitar players. We also think about scooping the mids as being something that sounds small and weedy. And that's because the mid-range on most amplifiers is 1 kHz, whereas scooping the mid-range like we're doing here is more centered around maybe 500 to 700 Hz. It's a very nerdy thing. But the gist of this anyway, we're talking about finger tones. So the gist of this is that when we start to really dig in, we're emphasizing those same frequencies that we get when we turn our EQ on. So let me just play real loud with the EQ on. In fact, you know what? Let's do this. Let's actually set the volume the same. And I'm going to try and recreate this EQ on sound with just my playing. So this is EQ on with a soft touch. Here's EQ off with a hard touch. EQ on. Soft touch, EQ on with a hard touch. Feels like it's a little higher than that. It might be somewhere around 4K, so let's try that. Here we go, this is hard touch, soft touch, hard touch. Yeah, that's probably about right, somewhere in that region. So we're emphasizing when we pick really, really hard, even on the neck pickup, we're emphasizing this upper mid-range kind of like poke territory. And that is very interesting because that is something that is directly related to your playing. Now, I've gone to great lengths to iron out the dynamic range here, but let's iron it out in another way. Let's iron it out by using loads of distortion. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to do the same experiment, but this time we're going to go to a very distorted sound, or a fairly distorted sound, at least by my standards. I am a bit of a gain hound, as you guys are well aware, I'm sure. Let's go to this sound. So this is my kind of like go-to. That's quite nice. Yeah, that's cool. So I'm going to stick with the back pickup this time. We're going to go to the bridge pickup, which is down here. Back pickup. You can tell I've hung out with old school guitar players for a while because, man, that's like, to me, that's the back pickup. That's the front pickup. But, you know, common parlance is bridge and neck. We're going to do the bridge pickup anyway. In here, that's the one that's on, and this one is not. So real quick, let's play soft and let's play hard and let's pay attention to the mid-range. So soft touch. Hard touch. Soft touch. Hard touch. So as well as pushing the amp harder, giving us a little more gain, we're also getting a bit more of that kind of mid-range aggressiveness coming through when we kind of dig in real, real hard. This is an interesting comment coming through here. Pete Thuman, I think any of you are Pete, have we met before? I'm not 100% sure, but hey, Pete's great to have you. I'm listening through my Mackie Mixer Crown Power Amp JBL speaker. Sounds like you're live in my house. Your audio is perfect. Thank you so much. Very, very kind of you. I'm into that. That's great. Pete Thurman, best guitar EQ in the world is Rockman and MXR Rack. And he's asking, do you know the trick of getting any amp to sound great? I have a few ways to do this, but Pete, I want to know what you think. So you tell us, man. You sound like a wise man who knows his gear. So let me know. I'd love to know what Pete thinks the trick to make any amp sound great is. I'm always keen to learn. I love hanging up with you guys because I'm always picking up tricks from you. So anyway, by pushing our pick attack, we start to get this real hard, forward, bitey, aggressive kind of sound, which is almost like engaging a boost. So let's do a little experiment with that. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to kick on my Sir Cocoa Boost, which is one of my favorite boosts. I really like it. What I'm going to do is I'm going to see if I can recreate the sound of this boost with my fingers. So let's go here real quick. I'm just switching it to the middle position with my foot, because of course I am. Let's play real soft. Let's throw in the Cocoa Boost, which is a mid boost, and that is going to give us, in this case, a 2 kHz boost. So it's going to take us from this to this. let's go back to the soft touch. Let's see if I can get that with my hands. That's no boost. This is yes boost. And then no boost. No boost with the soft touch. So what we can do with this this like kind of dynamic experiment in terms of how hard we're playing is we can control how much mid-range is in our sound essentially. When we really dig in like crazy, we super exaggerate the mid-range in the tone, which has the effect of giving us a mid-boost, which I think is pretty cool. So let's take another parameter here. So we've got that. Let's get into pick angle. So we've discussed this before. What do you guys remember happens? We're getting loads of from like Mariana Trench, whoever this person is. let's block that user. See you later. Okay, still maybe still be getting that in the chat, but we'll see. From the Mariana Trench. Wow, just endless mms. Okay. So anyway, Mariana Trench. See you later. What we were talking about there. Anyway, we're talking about pick angle. So pick angle. The angle of the pick on the string is this versus this. I want your predictions. Let me know in the comments. Do you think this is going to sound one way and this is going to sound another way? Is it going to have a different effect on the wound strings versus the plain strings? You tell me, because I'm going to play a little bit for you guys and we're going to see what happens. We're staying in the same place. We're going to pick hard. We're going to pick soft. Let's take a listen to the effect of pick angle on our dynamic with a clean sound. Here we go. Like clean. This is probably more clean than I've played in any of these streams in I don't know how long. So here we go. Sacred Godfire says she was transcribing the raunchy part of Welcome to the Jungle. Maybe the raunchy part of Rocket Queen. Who knows? We didn't get to that bit, I guess. Anyway, it's terrible, but it's also hilarious. So anyway, flat pick attack. Here we go. Let's take a listen. We're going to stick on the neck pickup for now. Now let's try with a very angled pick attack. Oh, Andy Keeley in with the projection, the predictions. More chirp with an angled pick, 100%. We get more chirp. Then we flatten it out. Less chirp. Now we've had the predictions, you tell me, dear users, good user in the brain, block user, dear viewers, dear friends, you tell me what you think you're hearing when we get to this kind of business, this kind of very, very angled pick attack. I want to know what you're hearing. What's the difference? Same velocity. Flat. Angled. Flat. Now that's with a soft touch. Let's try it with a heavy touch. Let's do flat with a heavy touch. If I can do it, there's a lot of resistance there. Jeez, did you hear that sharp bend? That's how hard I'm having to dig in here. Flat touch. So we got the comments coming in. Sacred Godslayer, flat is thicker sounding, 100%. Flat more dominant from Timothy Appling. That's very interesting. More overtones when flat, says Roy Lisbon. Now that is fascinating. Flat is thicker, says Blue Sumlin. Now, here's an interesting thing. Lee Hodgson, hey Lee, says pick angle affects your tone more than almost anything. I only use bevel picks. My favorite being Ernie Ball Prodigy. Hey, they're great picks. And the Red Bear Guthrie Govan signature pick has a unique bevel. Now, I will agree with you that it affects the tone, but I'm not sure it affects the tone more than anything, because here's the thing, right? Let's take a listen to a pick angle, the pick angle here. Let's take a listen, right? So flat. Angled. Now let's take a listen to the effect of dynamics with the same moderate angle. Now with flat. And now with a bevel, with the edge. Now that's interesting, because when we start to really leather the guitar, we really start to dig in, the effect of our pick angle actually gets minimized somewhat, and it just becomes clangy no matter what we do, because we're almost essentially like popping the string against the fretboard. So the, while there's a little bit more pick attack with this heavy touch, the actual angle doesn't have too profound an effect when we take our dynamics up to 10. However, when we start to back it down, we do notice a difference. Now let's throw a bit of distortion on and let's see what that does. So let's go with a very angled attack, very flat attack, very angled, very flat, so on and so forth. Now that is making a bigger difference, but let's dig in real hard and see what it does. So digging in real hard with a flat, with an angle. There we are getting a bit of a difference, but the difference again is, I think, a little less drastic than the difference between like a really, really hard attack and a really soft attack. But either way, we're still able to really manipulate the harmonic content and the EQ curve of our guitar using our hands. Now, this is the thrust of the whole stream, is that this business of is tone in the fingers. You'll notice it didn't say tone is in the fingers, it says is tone in the fingers, because no amount of fingers is going to take you from this to this. Because that's not how it works. You can't pick up an acoustic guitar, for example, start trying to play the Malmsteen licks and expect to have the delay arrive, let's say. But that does, that line of thinking does somewhat minimize the contribution of your fingers to the tone of your playing, because we can really influence the EQ of our sound. And more importantly, we can influence it on a note per note basis, which is not something we can do with our amp. You can, I guess, but it's probably going to be pretty inconvenient to play a particular note and then reach over and adjust the mid control in time for the next note, unless you're playing very, very few notes. And in case you haven't noticed, that's not really my bag. Anyway, so we've talked about the effect of picking dynamics. We've talked about the effect of your pick angle. Let's do one more little experiment, which is the effect of pick position on the string. Huge difference. This is also going to have an interaction between the dirty sound and the clean sounds. Let's go back to our clean sound. We're going to throw the very clean sound on, the super, super clean sound. Let's go to the neck pickup. Let's take a listen to this. So here we go. Let's take a listen to the effect of our pick. Way up here and way back here. Suddenly we're playing a coda, which is a really cool sound, by the way. Neck pickup, pick way back here. If you pick with a bridge pickup, you almost get a sitar. Almost. It's like, hey, it's a very, very Western guitar player's take on a sitar and a koto for that matter, but even still, a cool sound. So, man, big differences there. And let's take a listen to our dynamics. So we got this right here. Let's play medium. Let's play hard. Let's play soft. Let's play up here. Let's play hard. That's difficult. Let's play soft. That sounds lovely. Listen to that. Really, really pretty. Into that. That sounds tremendous. Lovely. I got a bit lost there, so let's go back here. Let's go right up in the neck. The reason Zappa played up here, the reason SLV played up here all the time as well. Quite difficult though, quite hard to do. Let's bring ourselves back here. And way back here. Difference. Enormous difference. What effect does that have on our distorted tone? Well, let's take a listen. Let's go to a pretty gainy tone, not the gainiest of gain tones. In fact, you know what? Fuck it. Let's go to the gainiest of gain tones. Let's see if it actually makes a difference, because this is the question. Like, this stuff, yeah, it all makes a difference when you're playing clean, but does it make a difference when you play with a bunch of gain? I think it does. Maybe it's placebo. Who knows? Maybe it's all between my ears. But let's find out. So we are going to stick with the back pickup. We're going to go way, way back here. Ba-dump, 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 ba-dump. And let's go with our pick position. Medium attack. In fact, let's vary our attack. Let's really leather this B string. Let's move it up here. Less prominent, but that's got a really interesting fluty character. Back here. Fascinating. And that is with all of the gain. So much gain, man. Now, one last parameter I want to talk about is what's going on with your fingers. So here's an interesting fact. We get told this all the time. We actually discovered this on stream last week. Here's some cool stuff, right? We got the sweet spot between pinched squeals and pinched harmonics, what Gilmour used. Oh yeah. On the first four notes of the solo, the second solo of On an Island. Yeah. So that is that kind of like, I don't even know what you'd call it. It's not even a semi-harmonic. It's just like a little bit of harmonic overtone on top of the note. So we're taking this to this. Probably even too much. Now, something we discovered on stream last week was the effect of finger position in the fretting area on your tone. And we took a look at Andy Timmons, a few of the great players, who seem to be kind of like contravening traditional guitar wisdom by fretting way in the middle of the fret, as opposed to right up against the fret wire, which is, you know, what we're told to do. We're told to fret against the fret wire. Listen to this. This is a fretting right in the middle of the fret. I'll try and keep my attack as consistent as I can. Middle of the fret. Up against the wire. Whoa. Did you hear that? Let's roll it back and forward. Did you guys hear all that extra high end up here? That is nuts. That's crazy. So the effect of our fretting position on the on our tone is huge. Listen to what's going on the high end there. So if all this stuff we're doing with our right hands affecting the mids, listen to what this fretting position is doing to the high end. So if we fret here, and then we fret here, then here. What about if we pick here? Let's strum here. Let's go with our front pickup. With, again, like the right against the fret wire. Let's bang it back a little bit. All that extra high end is coming through. What effect does that have on our distorted tone? Well, let's take a listen. Listen to the sustain. Go back here. Weirdly, that still sounds okay. As soon as we get here, starts to get muddy. Wow. Did you hear that dampen down the sustain when we got right on top of the fret wire? Now, That is really interesting because I'm not overhanging the fret there. It might look like I am. I'm not actually overhanging the fret, but when I get right up against the wire, man, what a difference in the sound. That is huge. So anyway, I want to go back to one of Lee Hodgson's comments because I'm sure you guys know who Lee Hodgson is, right? Lee's a phenomenal guitar player, phenomenal teacher. I haven't introduced him because, like, I don't think he needs introducing, really. Tons of great content over on Lick Library, by the way. So yeah, go do that, but also do GI Plus. Anyway, so Lee raised a really interesting point here regarding fingers and regarding hybrid picking. So let's just get to that real quick. Finger, flesh tone. That's a great name for a pedal, by the way. This is the Dan Electro flesh tone. Fingers, flesh is much fatter than many people realize. I use hybrid picking. Yeah, you know what it is? It totally can be. I absolutely agree with you there. What's interesting is that finger tone, or the effect of flesh on string, is really not talked about enough when it comes to actually using flat pick, as well as doing the hybrid picking thing, or just using your fingers. Now, everybody, and I mean everybody, whether you're a hybrid picker or not, uses skin or flesh to pick notes. What am I talking about? Well, what's this? What is that, if not a note picked with skin? That's kind of it, right? Surely. So if you're not a right-hand hybrid picker, if we do pull-offs, you're a hybrid picker because you're using skin to produce sound. It is my contention, by the way, that there are really only two sounds you can make on the guitar. Guthrie Govan talked about this. He said it was the sound of plastic and the sound of meat. And that was it. And I tried to get him to call his next album The Sound of Meat, but apparently the title is spoken for and it's taken a million years. Like, Erotic Cakes was like, I don't know, like 1918 or something it was released. We're waiting on the next one, Guthrie. I don't think he's watching this, but if he is, we're waiting on the next one. Call it The Sound of Meat. It's a great name. So there you go. Sound of Plastic, Sound of Meat. And The Sound of Plastic is the sound of plectrums. We've talked about that at length. The sound of meat is the sound of your hand, and the dynamic range you can achieve with the sound of fingers is hugely wider, way, 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 way wider than it is with just fingers. Let me show you, with just a pick. Let me show you what I'm talking about. So let's do this real quick. This is the sound of pick. Let's go as quiet as we can. Quiet as we can. Loud as we can. Quiet as we can. Now let's do it with a finger. Instantly louder. Quiet. This is as quiet as I can go with my pick. With my finger. So quiet you guys can't even hear it. Let's do it with distortion. Let's go to a moderate gain sound like this one. Already fingers, but let's take a listen. So pick, how quiet can I get it? Let's turn the noise gate off because you guys will have to put up with the hum for about 30 seconds, but I'll try it anyway. That's as clean as I can get it. Finger. Super clean. Let's do a chord. I can't get the double stop any cleaner than that, but with my fingers, way clean. Let's do loud. Let's do fingers. It's like more. You do so much more. It's more. More is more. I can't do the the Yngwie voice, but I can't do Arnold. So let's do the Arnold voice in lieu of Yngwie. More is more. Get to the chopper. So so fingers, huge dynamic range. But here's an interesting thing. Like, the huge dynamic range you get with your fingers extends to this hand as well, because we've got pull-offs. We talked about that. So if I do some pull-offs that are fairly gentle, interesting. What about if I do some really aggressive pull-offs? Interesting how much extra bite we can get out of that. This is not a very bitey sound. It sounds, maybe comes across that way. It doesn't feel that way. But yeah, let's do that again real quick. Let's compare our pull-off sound to Now, did you hear, last point in this, did you hear that extra little bite on that note there? That wah kind of tone, that squawky kind of sound. I didn't hit that note very hard at all. But what I did do was I allowed my thumb just to very gently graze the string as I was playing it, which again gave me this squawky, harmonic-y kind of sound. So, again, we could talk about this forever. I feel like I'm maybe going to do a course on this subject, because I think this is the sort of thing that is warranting of a course. So if you're interested in getting hold of courses like this, you can check out GI Plus, by the way. GI Plus is right up here. It is the subscription lesson platform from Guitar Interactive Magazine, where we cover everything from blazing shreddy technique through to amazing country lines. Andy Wood teaches country on there, which will tell you everything you need to know. Andy James is teaching the shreddy stuff. I have some shreddy stuff too. Rick Graham's on there. Tom Quayle talks about that sort of stuff. Does some fusion stuff as well. You name it. But we also have courses on theory, on melody, how to be more melodic, how to phrase more nicely, all that stuff. That's all available for you on GI Plus. You can check out my lessons and all of the other lessons that you'll find on there. And I've also thrown my pick away, but that's okay. I have more. I'm going to grab this one right here. In fact, do I have one in my pocket? Maybe I do. I should have a pick in my pocket. If not, then I, bad guitar player. There we go. Pick in pocket. Good. Check out GI Plus. Loads of courses on there. Amazing content. And it is ludicrously cheap. Just crazy, crazy, crazy cheap. Go check it out. Now, I'm going to give you guys a minute to get your questions in. We're going to do some Q&A very, very quickly. Let's quickly change the sign. There we go, Q&A, and let's have a minute to get your questions in the comments about anything guitar playing related. You name it, you want to know it, I want to give you the answer if I have the answer. Which, if I haven't got the answer, I'll make it up. I'm joking. If I haven't got the answer, I'll tell you. Anyway, we're going to play a little bit more. I'm going to go back to this backing track. This backing track is from my course, The Ultimate Guide to Melody and Phrasing, which is available as part of your GI Plus membership. Also, Technique Hot Fixes is available on the GI Plus store, also as part of your GI Plus membership. And we are about to drop Mastering Modes, Part 1. Ah, exciting. You guys asked for it. We have made it. Mastering Modes Part 1 will be in your GI Plus membership within the next couple of weeks. Keep your eyes peeled. If you haven't signed up yet, think about signing up now because you are not going to want to miss this course. It is super comprehensive. It's like 5 hours long and that's only Part 1. Note for note transcriptions, note for note tuition, rationale, scale diagrams, theory explained in a way that even rock guitar players like me with more hair than brain can understand. So let's play anyway. This is from The Ultimate Guide to Melody and Phrasing. 1 minute, get your questions in. Let's do this. Drop in a minute. The drop will come a little bit later on because we got to get on to the Q&A, so let's do it. Loads of great questions in already, so let's get into this. I love to play guitar, so I'll be picking up Nick's course 100%. Please do, man. I would love to know what you think about it. So if you do decide to pick it up, let us know in the comments next week what you thought. If you found it useful, Please do. Please tell me. Okay. Ah, Joe Johnson. Hey, Nick. Where and when can we see you live? Well, if you live in Germany, you can see me live a bunch of times this summer. I'll be out there with Blitzkrieg. We are doing Keep It True Festival. We're doing Headbangers Open Air. We are doing Storm Crusher as well, I believe. I think. So, yeah, if you're in the UK, you can check me out. Actually, you can come and see me on the 20th of this month. It's Sunday the 20th, 12 p.m. at the Newcastle Guitar Show, the Northeast Guitar Show. Guitar Show is back, everybody. So if you do see me at a guitar show, I'll be there. I'll be at the Birmingham one as well, and I may be at the London one too. Come up and say hi. Come up and say hello. We're allowed to now. So anyway, Timothy Appling, your string gauge, 10 to 46 currently, but it has been as high as 13s and as low as 8s, depending upon where my mood is taking me. Here we go. Oh yes, also, is Nick's course on GI? Yes, all of my courses, every single one of them, everyone I've ever made, and also everyone I'm ever going to make, is going to be available on GI Plus. So it's either in your membership or it will be in your membership very shortly. So you get more for free. If you want some more stuff from me, that is the place to find it. And I don't make courses anywhere else. You will only find my teaching material on GI Plus because I believe in it that much. I'm putting all of my eggs in that basket. So let's keep cracking. So we got some other stuff. Blue Sumlin, boosting the chain, where is best? That depends. If you want more gain, if you want a color onto your sound, then boost in front of your distortion stages is the way to go. If you want more level, boost after your distortion stages is the place to put it. Now, I would suggest considering your guitar's preamp or your amp's preamp, because I'm an amp gain kind of guy, considering your amp's preamp to be basically like a big distortion pedal. So if you want boost to lift the level of your amp's sound, put it in the effects loop before the reverb and delay. If you want to just kind of give your amp an extra bit of a goozle, a bit of extra kick up the front end for a bit more gain, or you just want to push certain frequencies to make your amp pop a little harder, maybe put it in front of the amp. Same is true for distortion pedals. Let's keep on going. Oh yeah, we totally should. Sacred Godslayer says you should promote that you have incredible courses like Minelli Jamal. I do. We have Minelli Jamal. We've got Michelangelo Batio. We've got Don Adler. Like, you have no idea. Just go look. We have so many great courses. Like, I couldn't I couldn't possibly go through all of them. Pete Thuman, say your name again. Nick Jennison again. Or your name again. There we go. So more questions. What else do we got? Ah, this is interesting. Where do you start example Dorian scale Santana? Style, middle of scale, beginning of scale, I'm guessing. Where do you find where to start using a modal scales Dorian? Okay, I get you. The place to find it is in Mastering Modes Part 1, which is coming, but I don't take that approach of, say, for example, let's take C Dorian, right? I don't take that approach of I'm going to play B major, or B flat major even. That noise gate is biting me. Let's go to a clean sound. Let's try that again. So, yeah. I don't take that approach of I'm going to play this and start on note number two, because I don't think that's super useful for guitar players. I think it's very useful for piano players. The reason for this is piano players have a different fingering for each of the major scales. They have 12 different fingerings they have to contend with. We have one, and we just move it around. We have seven, really, but you get the gist of it. We have one master fingering that goes across the entire fretboard. I take the approach of the pentatonic scale out. So you could argue that it's essentially triad out. We can start with a minor triad. You then take it to a minor seven. Then take that to a pentatonic scale. Minor hexatonic scale, and then this note becomes Dorian, this note becomes Aeolian, there's Dorian, here's Aeolian. In my mind, it's all pentatonic, and I can then either expand that out into a modal or a chromatic type sound, or I can reduce it to an arpeggio. If I so desire. And I can also visualize this as arpeggios within the scale. That's a different story for another day. I have gone deliberately quickly over that, Pete, because I got a course on it, mate. So if you sign up for GI Plus, you'll get that course in the next couple of weeks. It'll also be available in the store, which is going to be very, very exciting. Dead excited on it. Richard James, do you find pull-offs become clearer as your finger skin got harder? Yes, but especially hammer-ons. You can find this out for yourself if you go, did it get better? By soaking your fingers in water and then playing. And if you soak your fingers in water, you will find that your tone changes. Similar to using a soft pick, and I mean a soft material pick, like a felt pick, versus a hard pick. It's really interesting. Incidentally, if you're a guitar player and you want to warm your hands up, here's a tip for you. If you want to warm your hands up ahead of going on stage or whatever, don't run your hands into hot water. Do wash your hands. It's very important. We're not out of the woods with that stuff. Do wash your hands. And even when we are out of the woods, like, wash your freaking hands. I'm going to shake your hand at some point. Anyway, why am I telling you to wash your hands? Anyway, it's not the important point. So the point is, don't just run your hands under hot water to warm your hands up. Run your elbows up, or a little a sink up even with hot water. Stick your elbows in for a little bit, and then your fingertips will stay nice and hard, but your hands and arms will warm up. Joe Satriani talks about that. So it must be true. He also has very hairy arms. So it must be true. Anyway, let's keep cracking. We can at least get one more question in. At least one more. Elizabeth Blake Guitar says, that was amazing. Hey, thank you very much. Very, very kind. Jason M says, sounds great. Thank you very much, Jason. Where is the battery setup for your retrofitted Fluence pickups? Redig the sound of your soap bar. Okay, so I'm going to show you this on the close-up cam. On this guitar, because this is a McCartney 2, I have a battery pack already. Hey, look, you can see my ring light. There it is. And also the buckle rash on the back of this guitar. Wow. But normally what I do is I just cut a little hole in this, like this back plate. There's actually plenty of room inside of Paul Reed Smith. It's a little snug, but you can see I've got the rechargeable battery pack. So I have that on all my Fluence guitars because I don't like the idea of buying and discarding loads of 9-volt batteries. I realize I'm not going to save the world just on my own by not doing that, but I like to do my bit. And also, it's a pain. I'd rather just plug my guitar in and charge it. I've turned up to a gig before where neither of my guitars has been charged. For whatever reason, they've just been on the brink. And I've picked two guitars off the rack that I've forgotten to charge. And I've gone, oh, idiot. And I charged one of them in about 10 minutes. And I got enough charge to get through the gig. And while I was playing, I had the other one on charge. So the battery pack, very much worth doing. Hey, Craig's in. Hashtag morning. Hello, mate. Morning. Great to have you. What else do we have? Real quick. Steve Hawthorne, scale length dictates my string gauge choice. Does it for you? Yes, it does. It absolutely does. Because a shorter scale length is going to have a slacker feel, which if you want to maintain the play feel, will necessitate a thicker string. So let's keep on going. We got maybe one more question if we have time. Seagull Rock says, rock squawks boil your strings at the same time. Not if you're about to go on stage. Maybe don't take your strings off and then put them straight back on if you're about to go on stage. Oh man, there was a really good question further up and I totally forgot. So listen, if you guys want to ask us questions, feel free to send us a message on Instagram at Guitar Interactive Magazine. So you can follow us on Instagram, Guitar Interactive Magazine. You can also send us videos if you're playing there. I'd love to see you guys play. We've done some critique stuff before. We haven't done any critique in a while. So if you want to get your playing on one of these streams, hey, video it, send it to us or tag us in it. I would love to get you guys on these streams playing some guitar. In the meantime, I must bid you adieu. We've gotten to the hour. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive Magazine and Guitar Interactive GI Plus, which is the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive Magazine. I'm going to play for another minute or two, and then I'm going to show you what GI Plus is all about. Let's get at least through the drop on that backing track. If you want to learn how I would solo over this backing track, you can do so at GI Plus as part of your membership on the Ultimate Guide to Melody and Phrasing. If you want to be better at playing this stuff full stop, you can check out Technique Hot Fixes, which is going to show you how to improve your technique in as little as 10 minutes. Great courses, and I'm really proud of them. And also, look, loads more in there. So, hey, if you haven't signed up, consider doing so. I'd love to have you on there. My name's Nick Jennison. I'll see you next week, where we are going to be discussing tension. Is it your best friend? Is it your worst enemy? We'll find out. As you might expect, the answer is somewhere in the middle. But in the meantime, let's play. Guys, thanks for having me. Let's take a look at some of this stuff. This right here is some of what you get in your GI Plus membership. I will see you next week. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.